Johnny Unitas was all that America asked of a man in the 1950s. He was that skinny, crew-cut, no-cry, stand-up guy. He never got word that he wasn't supposed to make it. Blessed with a hard nose and a strong arm, he had a heart that pumped ice water with 2 minutes left.
Number 19, Johnny Unitas.
You talk about come from behind wins, you talk about passing marks, you talk about big plays, you talk about anything in quarterbacking, Johnny Unitas set the standard for what quarterbacks are today.
There was something magic about it. It was something dramatic.
When he walked out on the field with his high-top black shoes, he had nothing but confidence flowing off of him.
He thought he could do anything, any place, any time, take the team right down the field, and even when he won, he was unhappy. That's how competitive he was.
He had a swagger about him, and with the swagger came a kind of had a little smirk on the corner, and kind of as if to say, don't ever tell me that I'm not better than you are.
Sometimes you can tell by the way a quarterback sounds that he doesn't like the play or he's not sure of the play. You never had that feeling with him. He always displayed the idea that what I'm going to do is going to hurt you.
I'll never forget the pregame settings. He always said exactly the same thing. Talk's cheap.
I would try to do something to rattle him with conversation or something. And it was the most interesting thing. He would look at me, and he would never show one concern as I could see it.
I used to walk over and talk to Johnny on a, you know, when he was, like he'd call timeout. And I said, John, you know you don't need no timeout, man. He said, oh, you know you need the rest.
You could hit him, you could knock him down, you could break his nose, he'd get right back up and come back.
Sometimes they'd hit him and his finger would come at pointing this way and he wouldn't even come out of the game. He'd run to the sideline, he'd hold his hand out and he'd say, fix this thing.
A guy broke through the line, hit him, pushed his head in the ground. He called the same play, let the guy come through and broke his nose with the football. I said, that's my hero. I dug him before that, but when he did that, I said, yeah, that's our leader.
A 1960 game in Wrigley Field with Chicago. They put tremendous pressure on him. He was bleeding from the nose and above the eye. It was late in the game, into the last 2 minutes.
Bill George got there just before I did and had him low, and I hit him high, and that thing went through and just cut his nose. We thought he was out.
I couldn't even look him in the face. It was so bloody. He reached down and got a handful of mud and dirt and stuck up his nose like this and packed him. He said, I'll be okay.
The trainer wanted to take him out. He said, you take me out, I'll kill you. You know, he didn't want to leave, and he didn't leave. And then he threw a pass to Lenny Moore in the last minute of the game, and we beat the Bears.
Tough, gutsy, even thought heroic, Unitas set one record early in his career that has gone unchallenged.
Now, when you think of a man who throws touchdown passes in 47 consecutive games, that's hard to imagine.
A last chance pass from Unitas hits Richardson, and he steps over the line for the TD. It's a 13-10 win for the Colts.
Unitas' streak of 47 consecutive games throwing touchdown passes is impressive, especially when you look at how far he exceeds second place. Nobody else has had a streak longer than 30.
What Unitas lacked in physical gifts, he more than made up for with a perfect quarterbacking mind.
I don't think John had the greatest arm, but he sure as hell got that ball to whoever he wanted to throw it to. I know he had the greatest brain.
I thought that John Unitas could read my mind, and I thought he knew what defense I'd call in this situation. So I'd call another defense. And after he beat all nine of my defenses one time, I got in the huddle and I said, well, guys, he's beaten all nine. I said, does anybody have a suggestion?
I tell you, you could never feel safe in any game with Johnny Unitas. Sooner or later, you could expect him to get hot. And when he was hot, nobody was better than Johnny Unitas.
He's a killer, man. He had an instinct. In the 2 minutes, if he got you down to the 2 minute drill where he was a few points behind, you got a problem. He was the best I ever seen at it.
What Unitas asked of himself was no less than what he expected from every player under his command.
John's a quiet guy, but everybody respected John. If John say do something, man, you better do it.
I might say something nice about a certain coach, and John would say, Billy, the guy's a jerk. And I knew the conversation was over. It didn't matter what I thought.
John was the kind of a guy that if you didn't stay out after practice to work on timing, he didn't throw to you in the game.
He's the type of guy that if he goes back there and there's this right guard over here not doing a good job, he'd give him the devil.
Ernie Stotner, he beat me 3 times in a row, and John Unitas, he says, can't you block him? He says, if you do it again, I'm going to take you out the game.
Johnny did whatever he had to do. If he had to cuss you out, he would cuss you out. If our center was breaking down, immediately, Unitas was saying, hey, what do you want me to do? You want me to come up there and help you block him? I got to do my job. You do your job.
The opposition hit him in the mouth, and I get back to the huddle, and John's eyes would kind of blink, and he'd look at me, and he'd say, 74. Well, I know who it is. That's all he would say.
I got clotheslined and knocked out. I said, who did that to me? Who did that to me? Unitas said, shut up. I'm the only one that talk in the huddle.
Out of the huddle and off the field, Unitas remained the captain.
As an outsider, if you didn't really know him or you weren't on the team, you'd say he's cocky.
It was hard to get close to John. He didn't want to show any favorites, you know. He wanted to be over here. And the team was over here, but when we came in, he was, you know, he was still we.
Unitas never, like, hung with any group of guys. Friendly enough to say, hey, come on, man, let's have a beer. Yeah, I think I have a couple beers, you know, and whatever, and laughing and joking with the guys. But then, okay, well, we've done this, now it's time for me to do what I got to do.
Had a memory like an elephant. If you hurt him or if he thought that you invaded his privacy, the next time around you were going to get short shrift from him.
You'd ask him a question, he'd answer it. That'd be it. There'd no be explanation, no nothing. Yes, no.
Nothing bothered him. It's very, very rare that you would see John express an outward emotion. He'd just feel that, you know, this happened and that happened, and in his mind, whatever it was justified.
But for a post-war generation just beginning to embrace professional football, Unitas filled the hero's role from head to toe.
If you're talking 50s and early 60s, of course. Look at that haircut, no shoes, my goodness. Yeah. Johnny was the man.
The Pat Boone Chevy Showroom.
Johnny, on behalf of Sport Magazine, Pat and I would like to present you with this beautiful 1959 Chevrolet Corvette as your award for being chosen the outstanding player in the championship playoff game with the New York Giants.
Thank you very much, Ed.
But John never really could understand why America was making such a fuss over him. He wasn't thinking of how many television appearances he was going to make. I think John was a football player, period.
There was nothing fancy about Johnny Unitas. He was gritty, and grittiness was very much admired. Just as Martin Luther King and Elvis Presley were giants of the decade, Unitas was a giant of the decade. He converted a nation from what was basically a baseball country to a football country. Not overnight, but he started that change.
As identifiable as the Johnny Unitas image was in the NFL, there was a time when he was the quarterback nobody wanted.
The city of Pittsburgh has a lot to do with Johnny Unitas and the fiber of the person that he is, and that he was as a football player.
Western Pennsylvania, many of the people in the steel mills, coal mines in the 40s and 50s certainly were blue-collar workers, and as athletes, that was the way out of the mills or the mines at the time.
Unitas was one of four children raised in a blue-collar household in Pittsburgh's South Side section. When Johnny was 5, his father died of kidney failure, leaving his Lithuanian-born mother to raise the family by herself.
His mother, Helen, she was working 2 jobs, and that's where John Unitas gets his work ethic from.
my mother instilled plenty in him. And the idea of you just don't quit.
She had a saying, if you had a need, it would be discussed. But if it was a want, she didn't want to hear about it.
By 12, Unitas had discovered his passion, throwing a football.
He just practiced incessantly, throwing passes. Took a piece of bull rope and tied a tire on a tree limb, and Shirley used to go and swing the tire back and forth and try to throw the ball through it.
Oh, he was so thin when he got tackled, it just made you cringe because you didn't know if he was going to get up or not.
Johnny's ability to absorb pain was demonstrated when a freak accident occurred at home.
My mom had an automatic on a mantle. Apparently, he went up there, got a chair or a ladder, and got the gun down. And I guess he took the clip out.
And didn't know that there was a bullet in the chamber.
So he must have had it in his hand like this and been looking at it. And he pulled the trigger and whacked his finger.
The bone was shattered, but he played with a splint on for the whole season. But he didn't cry when that happened either.
In his dreams, the 145-pound Unitas fit into just one college uniform, but it turned out he wasn't the right size.
John told me he wanted to go to Notre Dame, but they took a look at him and said, no, we don't want you.
He went to Notre Dame and they didn't keep him. And I once mentioned that to Frank Leahy. He said, did John Unitas really show up at Notre Dame? I said, yes, and they threw him out. So he turned and he just stared out the window.
He was a guy that could make the most out of what seemed to be nothing. He was not a celebrated high school player. The University of Louisville was about the only place it would take him.
One day during the summer, I got a letter from him saying, I want to come to Louisville. We really got him because of persistence, but nobody else wanted him.
After five games of his freshman year, Unitas was named the starting quarterback. Despite injuries his junior and senior seasons, he passed for more than 3,000 yards and 27 touchdowns in his college career. But doubt lingered when the Steelers selected him in the ninth round of the 1955 NFL draft.
He did have a little trouble learning the pro game, and his arm, of course, was so strong that it was he threw just as hard at 10 yards as he did at 40.
The head coach was a guy named Walt Kiesling, and Art Rooney's twin sons were ball boys traveling with the team. And they told him, Dad, the best quarterback out here is Johnny Unitas, but the coach will only let him throw to us on the sidelines.
Kiesling had hoped to be able to give him $100 a week to practice with the team every day, just have him there and train him. And the Steelers were having a little trouble with the preseasons, hadn't won any. Ticket sales were poor, and unfortunately the owner said, we can't afford to carry these extra players.
They gave him $10 and told him that he could leave. He kept the $10, put it in his pocket, and hitchhiked home because he was married and was going to have a baby, and he needed $10.
He was very dejected, very disappointed. He had his heart set on playing for his hometown team.
While working construction in Pittsburgh, Unitas was approached to play at $6 a game for a local semi-pro team called the Bloomfield Rams.
Played our first game, he just played defense. He didn't play any offense because he didn't know the plays. And after that, he played every offense and defensive play for the rest of the season.
A lot of the fields they played on were devoid of grass, and they'd come out with an oil machine and oil field down to keep the dust down before they ever kicked off.
There was sewers right in the middle of the field, and glass was all over the place, all over the fields, and you got cut and bruises and whatever.
In late 55, the Colts received a letter urging them to sign Unitas. Coach Weeb Eubank took a look, then took a chance.
But it was all through friends who had seen him. I trusted a friend, and we needed the quarterback.
When he first came to Baltimore, he was Unitas. Nobody even knew what his bloody name was.
I look over, and here's this skinny guy, you know, with a crew cut, and he's got a bad shoulder. I said, who the hell is that guy? I said, I don't know, is he gonna make the team? He's got a bad shoulder.
I went to the Colts training camp in Baltimore and worked with John. John looked you right in the eye, and you could tell he was, you know, absorbing what you were telling him. It was obvious to me that he had the raw material to be a great quarterback.
It was an exhibition game.
And here comes this clown out on the football field, and he looked like Humpty Dumpty. And he had an old jersey pulled up with rubber bands holding the sleeves up. And you just knew that they weren't going to keep this guy, whoever he was. And all of a sudden, he was zipping here, zipping there. Who is this guy?
In the fourth game of the 56th season, Unitas was called into action when starting quarterback George Shaw suffered an injury against the Chicago Bears. His debut was a disaster.
When Shaw went down, we were all very, very concerned. And then Unitas came in, and of course we remember that first play.
I saw the pass coming, anticipated the pass, and intercepted the pass. Just ran it back for a 61-yard touchdown. And I enjoyed that.
So his first completed NFL pass was a touchdown to a defensive back. And getting hit with that type of setback is going to affect him. And that's just the way he played his whole career.
He maybe got caught and cut, but he knew. He knew. And that's the important part. I'm good. I know I'm good. I know I'm better. Why did they do this to me? I'm going to show these guys. And he just kept plugging in there and plugging in there and plugging in there and pow, he shut him down.
Against the Giants for the World Championship of Professional Football.
December 28th, 1958 was the day professional football came of age. 40 million watched on national TV. In the pregame hum of 64,000 strong at Yankee Stadium, one man's history rode the airwaves.
That's what put John Unitas into everybody's living room, everybody's mind, and in many cases, everybody's heart.
United takes to Amici, throws down in the end zone, and it's a touchdown.
Unitas led the Colts to a 14-3 advantage in the second quarter, only to see the Giants rally in the second half.
And it's good to Gifford, and Gifford goes in for the score.
We were in pretty good control of the football game, and we had a third down and about a yard.
And they gave the ball to Frank Gifford, and Frank ran off tackle, and he made the yard. And the officials didn't think he made the yard.
I knew we were behind the line of scrimmage, and Gifford starts on. I made that first down. And I said, why don't you shut up and get back in the huddle? And then they're hollering at their coach, Jim Lee Howell, go for it, go for it, you know? And he said, no, punt the ball.
With 2 minutes remaining, Unitas and the Colts took over at their 14.
John always had that air about him that, you know, somehow, some way, he's going to do it. He's going to win this ball game.
There was no way that we thought that Johnny Unitas could bring that team that far and get a field goal. No way we thought that.
I think if I had one shot at one game, the final drive, I needed one quarterback to do it. It could be Unitas.
Third down coming up, 10 to go. Again, Unitas is back. Sets, looks, throws out to the right. Good to Moore, I believe. Lenny Moore.
The completion gave a pale ray of hope to the Colts. Unitas did the rest.
Back goes Unitas to throw. Sets, throws. It's good to Berry. Berry in the middle of the Giants secondary. Shakes one man off. Shakes another. Is finally caught up with at about the 50-yard line and down at the 50-yard line.
In our system, I could talk to John during the ball game and say, I can beat this guy on this route, or don't throw to me. I can't get open right now. This guy's got me covered. That's the way we operated.
First and 10 to go on the 50. He fakes, throws to Berry. Berry shakes off one man. Carl Ibbets is tackled by another.
We were watching Baltimore drive, and we were watching Unitas to Berry, Unitas to Berry, and I thought, oh, no.
The sweep up the field was like General Patton and his crew just moving across Europe. Unstoppable.
Unitas back to throw, does throw. It's good to Berry. Berry shakes loose from one man to the 20, the 15. He's down on the 13-yard line.
It was, 8 yards, 12 yards, 10 yards. It was relentless. Kept thinking that our defensive team would stop him somewhere along the line. And I guess most ordinary mortals, they would have stopped, but he wasn't ordinary.
There's the kick, and the kick by Myra is good, and the game is tied with 7 seconds to go.
That was the kind of drama that football had never seen before, to take the team down the field
kicked the field goal. Nobody heard of a two-minute drill. Johnny Unitas invented the two-minute drill.
In the first sudden-death game in NFL history, the Colts defense stymied the Giants on their first possession and gave Unitas the chance to ply his magic again.
Third down about 15. Unitas going back to throw. This time he gets protection. Starts to run with the ball. Now he throws. It's good to Berry. He's at the 45.
If you thought he was going to pass, he'd run. If you thought he was going to run, he'd pass. We, Bubank, on the sidelines had no clue what Johnny was going to do. He'd send in a play and he'd ignore it.
This time,
gives
to
Amici.
He finds the big hole in the center. Amici rams his way forward, deep into payoff territory.
They've probably been as gifted players, as gifted quarterbacks, but nobody was so totally unpredictable as John Unitas.
See, the great thing about the ending of the game was the courage of the Colts. And they're throwing the ball all the way to bing, bang, bing, bing. And they get in close where you could kick an easy field goal. Mm-mm. We're going in and score.
He passes. Mutchler got that ball and went out of bounds.
We didn't go for the field goal. And I think confidence is a key word. At that stage of the game, there wasn't any question about our confidence in Unitas to put the ball in the end zone.
Then newspaper men said, "What's wrong with you?" And when they asked me, I said, "Ask Unitas," because he's the one who called it.
He said later that if you know what you're doing, you're not really taking a chance. And he didn't mean that in a braggadocio manner at all. But it's just he had a quiet confidence.
Unitas gives to Amici. The Colts are the world champions. Amici scores.
The Colts won the title 23-17. And Unitas, who threw for 349 yards, had taken the NFL into the future.
I don't know of any single game in any sport that had as much effect on the future of that league as that game did on the National Football League.
After that game, in the coming years, people said, "Oh, I gotta watch pro football. Now Sundays will be special." Because TV captured not only what was at the stadium, it almost made it a bigger drama than even if you're at the park.
A year later, the Colts and Giants met again for the NFL title, this time in Baltimore's Memorial Stadium.
Unitas is back. Unitas throws, completed to Moore. He's at the 40, the 35. Moore goes for a touchdown.
Throwing for 264 yards and two touchdowns in another peerless performance, Unitas gave Baltimore another reason to love him.
When we won the second World Championship in 59. It wasn't crazy. You know, I mean, it was nice, but we've been here before. You know, this is the second go-round.
If winning was losing its luster for some of the Colts, they and their leader were gaining fans by the millions, coast to coast.
You talk about America's team and everybody says Dallas, bull. Baltimore Colts were America's team. We had fans all over the country because of one guy, John Unitas.
What is it, music?
Yeah, it's a Colts marching song. It's very tasteful, very tasteful.
There was a real love affair between Unitas and the people of Baltimore. It was a time when, in the late 50s and early 60s, in a town such as Baltimore, you would see the Colts around town. You would see them at the supermarket or buying clothes or at the drugstore, and you felt like they really represented you. They were one of you.
Unitas gave the city of Baltimore quite a bit of pride in itself. Every kid on the playground wore high-top shoes and crew cuts.
I would say John was certainly the biggest icon that Baltimore has ever had.
After passing for almost 9,000 yards and 84 touchdowns in his first four seasons, Unitas became a target throughout the NFL. Over the next 3 years, his interceptions outnumbered his touchdown passes. In 1963, Weeb Eubank was replaced by Don Shula, a former Unitas teammate. The mix of Shula and Unitas proved volatile.
Don was a young coach and now had to come in and coach the number one quarterback who had already won two world championships. And it was a clash of two strong personalities.
Those guys are thoroughbreds. They're not going to be hugging and kissing all the time. Of that, you can rest assured.
Shula was a disciplinarian, and John wasn't used to that. He lost John when he started to overrule some of the things that John wanted to do.
I was
very, very aggressive, and always said what I felt. And, you know, at times that works, at times it annoys people.
He tried to make the Colts Team Shula instead of Team Unitas. And as long as Johnny Unitas is around, it will always be Team Unitas.
Unitas knew how to get the team to back him. He would say, we're not going to run that play. This will work. Don't let me down.
John wanted to call his own play. It wasn't that John fought Shula all the way, which he didn't. Anything Shula wanted to do, John did. But sure, he resented not being able to call his plays when he wanted to.
Yeah, there was a clash there, and it's still a clash there, I believe.
Despite the friction, Unitas played brilliantly under Shula, winning MVP awards in 64 and 67. When the battle-worn Unitas struggled with an elbow injury in 68, Earl Morrill led the Colts into Super Bowl III. But Unitas was ready to play against Namath and the Jets.
Shula went to him and said, look, Earl got us here, so I'm going to start him. But I want you to be ready if things don't go right. And John said, I understand that, you know, and said, fine.
He still didn't have the great velocity and strength in his arm yet. And I'd had a good year. A lot of things happened in that game that you don't ordinarily see.
Morrill throws downfield, intercepted. That is the third interception of the ball game for New York.
With Morrill ineffective and the Colts down 7-0 at the half, the question was, how soon would Unitas see action?
Well, my plan was to give Earl one more series in the third quarter. And if we didn't get back into the ball game, that I was going to go to Unitas.
I thought Shula handled it about as well as he could have, considering what Morrill had done, even though Morrill was having a bad day. The Colts didn't have the ball very much in the third period. Maybe Unitas could have brought him back again. I would not say that he couldn't.
After Morrill failed to score on the Colts' first two possessions, Shula turned to Unitas. The Jets were leading 13-0 late in the third quarter.
The ball will come out to the 20-yard line, and John Unitas is now the quarterback for the ball.
When Johnny came on the field in the Super Bowl, there was almost like, oh, me, what's going to happen? Because you knew he was a man. You knew he could bring them back.
Once we saw him try to throw the ball, we knew that, hey, you know, he's not the man that he used to be.
Unitas back to throw, four men out on the pattern, good protection, into the end zone, the pass is intercepted, the fourth interception of the ball game.
John Unitas at that point was damaged goods. His arm wasn't what it was.
On his third possession, Unitas directed a time-consuming 80-yard touchdown drive. The Colts regained possession on an onside kick with 3 minutes to go, but it was too little, too late. The heroics of 1958 seemed in another age.
Time runs out. The Jets have won the Super Bowl.
You know, I probably didn't put him in as soon as I should have put him in.
I asked him once, had you started Super Bowl III, do you think Baltimore would have won? He said, I didn't need that much time.
I'll never forget a Monday night game. We're playing the Green Bay Packers, and we ran a reverse for about 50 yards, and we got a holding penalty. So we're back in the huddle saying, who was holding on the thing? It's John Unitas. He ran over and grabbed a guy, jerked him on the ground. He was a football player first and a quarterback second.
When we return, an aging, battle-scarred Johnny Unitas has a hard time letting go. But when he finally does retire, he finds life outside of the huddle can be more complicated than the two-minute drill.
I remember seeing Johnny Unitas the first time. It was late in his career. And here's the great Johnny Unitas sitting on the trainer's bench, and he'd stripped down to just his shorts. And I look at this Johnny, that's Johnny Unitas? That's the greatest quarterback in my time right there? That's him? He does it with that body?
He took a beating. He took a beating and got up after he played, knocked him down, get up again.
I don't think that he was entirely immune to pain, but he had a high threshold. He could take a lot. The other players knew it. That's why they respected him so much. A lot of players would have been out for the season. He came back and played with bad elbows, bad knees.
all types of injuries.
In 1971, he tore his Achilles. But when he takes off his shoes and his socks, the wound is open, and he's at practice. And so we're all saying, for gosh sakes, John, cool it. I think he really just felt like that's what you're supposed to do.
His legs were giving him fits. I know his arm and his hand was pretty bad shape. But he stayed in there. The doctor said they don't know how he even threw the ball, you know, the last couple of seasons. But John is John.
Very seldom do you ever see him out of the pocket. He knew that's where his place was. You come and get me. And they broke his jaw. They punctured his ribs. They did everything to him. He stayed in that pocket.
Even when his stats were declining, his presence out in the field, his leadership, his sense of generating esprit de corps on a team was irreplaceable.
His arm wasn't as strong as his early days, but he still had that confidence. He could still do it.
He took us on a late drive in 1970 to beat the Oilers, and time was running out. In fact, we were out of timeouts, and he threw a post corner to Roy Jefferson from about 30 yards to win the game. And on the airplane going back, I said, John, did you see Jefferson catch the ball? He said, no. I said, how could you not watch him? He said, because I threw a perfect pass. Nothing more I could do. My job was done.
2 years after the debacle of Super Bowl III, 37-year-old Johnny Unitas was leading the Colts into another Super Bowl.
We really wanted that. For him, we were not nearly as physically gifted as the Cowboys. But I think also it would have been very nice for John to get to get another championship in which he directed the show.
Unitas wanting to throw, throwing, and it is. And it's going to be a touchdown for Mackey, 75 yards.
After the deflected touchdown pass to Mackey, Unitas was knocked out of the game. In an ironic role reversal, Morrill came off the bench and led the Colts to a field goal attempt with 9 seconds left. But when rookie kicker Jim O'Brien had an attack of the jitters, it was Unitas who stepped up.
I remember before the field goal, Unitas just going up to him, and I don't know what he said to him, but whatever it was, it calmed him down, it relaxed him.
There is the snap. The kick is up, and it's long enough. It is!
When that ball went through the uprights, we hit the lottery. Forget about the past, we won Super Bowl V.
In 1972, Unitas underwent two fundamental changes. He and wife Dorothy divorced after 18 years, and the Colts' new general manager, Joe Thomas, benched him.
There was a phone call for John Unitas. So I said, hey, John, it's for you. And he was on the phone maybe 30 seconds. And John says, it was Thomas, I'm down. He told John Unitas that he wasn't playing anymore on the telephone. Yeah. He never changed expression. He was the same guy.
As the season wore on, it became increasingly clear that the Unitas era at Baltimore was ending. On December 3rd, his fans filled Memorial Stadium, hoping for one last memory.
I was the starting quarterback, and everybody was there because it was the last home game, the last opportunity to see John play. And I ran into the end zone and got hit on the hip. As I came to the sideline, John Sandusky said, listen, everybody wants John to go into the game, but he's not going to go in. And Sandusky talked to John, and they both looked down at me. I pointed to my hip, and John stood up, and the crescendo started to build. And it got louder and louder. The place was just alive all of a sudden. And the ball got turned over, and John, with that familiar gait, ambled onto the field.
His first pass is a pass to Eddie Hinton. Eddie Hinton grabbed that ball and just ran like he's never run before in his life. And as Eddie Hinton is crossing that goal line, this plane comes around and Unitas, we stand. And that place went absolutely crazy. A great tribute to John Unitas, and it showed John the appreciation of all the fans that he had here.
In January of 1973, 39-year-old Unitas was sold to San Diego, where a starting job and a $250,000 salary awaited.
the Baltimore Colts have traded me. They've made a situation almost impossible for me to come back and work for them. I would still like to play football. I think I can be of help to someone for another 2 years.
He'd never gotten so much money to play. Gene Klein, the owner of the team, wanted him on the team because of his name and his reputation. He wanted to raise the consciousness of the guys on the team.
Just before John signed, he looked up. He said, "Are you sure you want me to sign this?" I think that would have been a pretty good time to decide that the Chargers weren't getting the John Unitas of other years.
I remember seeing him in that San Diego helmet with the lightning bolts. And I mean, you know, that was like seeing some ballet dancer wearing, an ice hockey uniform. It made no sense whatsoever.
I think you only had to go like one series of downs into that season to decide that John Unitas was misplaced. On his first play, he took the ball, took a couple steps, and just tumbled over backwards.
He didn't have the arm any longer. He just didn't have it. He was at the end of a very long, obviously a great career.
As the Chargers stumbled to a 2-11-1 record, an unprotected Unitas played 5 games, completing less than half of his passes. After the season, NFL Commissioner Pete Rozelle fined 8 Chargers and placed them on probation and a drug crackdown.
Johnny hated every moment on that team. He was on a team that was unlike probably any team he's ever been on from a character standpoint. Too many of the guys were on steroids. Too many of them were taking amphetamines. Too many of them were doing marijuana.
We were pretty much in disarray as an organization. I remember one day he said, "Boy, it smells like somebody smoking rope down that hallway," and I didn't know what he was talking about.
Johnny Unitas was one of the nicest men and square shooters that you ever wanna know, man. Stood out like a sore thumb.
I know he was happy to get out of there, and I think if he looked back on it now, he'd probably say, "Hey, I wish I'd have stayed here and retired."
You know, San Diego wasn't a good, decision for him, but that cannot take away the memories I have of Johnny Unitas.
Unitas throws, completed the board. He's at the 40, the 35, four goes for a touchdown. Unitas barks the signal. Unitas back to throw, looks for a receiver, throws one, it's completed to Richardson, and Richardson scores!
He was the last of the guys who actually was a quarterback. All of these guys that you see nowadays are half quarterbacks. A quarterback, in the traditional sense, looked at the defense, thought up the play, gave the play to the players, and executed. Unitas ran the show.
While Unitas and his new wife, Sandy, raised a family, he searched for new challenges off the field. Hired by CBS as a color analyst for NFL broadcasts, he was not outspoken enough.
He's the best guy in the world, but he just doesn't have the personality to come across on television or at a dinner. And he's not far from the way the athletes are today. Show me a quiet athlete today who's a star, and I'll show you guys not make a lot of money.
I think that Johnny Unitas sometimes probably struggles with the demons of, having been a great, great, great quarterback, when not nearly the attention was given to it that's given to it now.
He'd be making $30 million instead of what some of these guys are making today.
Ladies and gentlemen, may I have your attention, please?
The rule book does not define the word player.
And as you say, Pepper, there's no way.
For Unitas, life after 18 seasons of calling plays has incurred some losses. Bowling alleys in the 60s, a Florida land deal in the 70s, and a restaurant in the 80s. When he handicapped pro games for a gambling publication in 1981, the NFL ended his special consultancy to the Colts. In 1991, he filed for bankruptcy under Chapter 11.
He didn't want to file bankruptcy, but that was the only thing he could do.
Unitas had the cards in Baltimore. He had a great offensive line. He had good players. He knew how to run the table. Out of football, he didn't have the sharpness. He didn't really have the broad knowledge. And he thought he could do it, and he couldn't.
I just think that there was probably never enough money for the number of years he put in. And I think that a couple of his business partners ran off and left him holding the bag on some notes, and John was
such a great guy for sticking it out. He couldn't run away from it. He stayed and made them good.
Johnny Nice was always in charge on the field, and he trusted nobody. He trusted himself. You know, he had the ball. He directed where everything went. And you would think that naturally this would carry over in the rest of his life. But that's not necessarily the case.
Well, he was just too trusting, that's all. He relied on people when they didn't do what they were supposed to do. And it cost them big time. It knocked them down a little bit, but didn't hold them back. He worked it out.
Unitas suffers almost constant pain from old injuries. He's had both knees replaced, and in 1993, he suffered a near-fatal heart attack. Yet number 19 has stayed the course, borne the hurt.
I saw John and his hand was arthritic. It was obvious that he was in pain. And I know John. John is a very proud man. And he didn't like nobody feeling sorry for him.
He never complains. And if you see him, how you doing, John? Great, Billy. I'm doing great. Never felt better. Everything's okay.
John's just very quiet, is reserved, doesn't like to be high profile, just does his own thing.
He's not one for too much BS, and or none at all.
Here's a guy who maybe off the football field is of average intelligence, average schooling, all of that, but put him on a football field and he becomes a genius.
He never changed who he was. He never became or tried to become something he wasn't. He was an incredibly gifted football player, but he was a regular guy.
After the Colts packed up and moved to Indianapolis under the cover of night in 1984, Unitas demanded that his name and exploits be stricken from the Colts record book. Nothing personal, but he never played in Indianapolis. Simple, yes. Honest, almost painfully so. But this is number 19. What you see is what you get. For ESPN Classic Sports Century, I'm Chris Fowler.
Professional football began as a runner's game.